Turn to the book of Matthew, in chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18, and reading from verse 18. Truly I say to you, whatever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again I say to you that if two of you shall agree on earth concerning anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them by my Father who is in heaven. For where two or three have been gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. And then the book of Philippians, Paul's Ephesian to the Philippians, chapter 2, and verse 9. Therefore God also has highly exalted him and given him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth, and things under the earth. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the truths that will be shared tonight. I thank you for the spirit of revelation and understanding. And Father, as your word goes forth tonight, may it go forth unhindered and unrestricted. And may it find a resting place in those who would hear it. And may the understanding be opened to look into the heavenly realm and to see what is happening. Lord, how they should respond to what is happening and how you work on our behalf. We thank you for that, Father, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Tonight I want to speak on angelic and demonic forces. We've been looking at the way of blessing. We've been looking at how God's power is released into the earth through human vessels, through the power and the forces of the Spirit, through words that are spoken forth. But once that word has gone forth and a creation is to take place and things are to occur in the earth, there are other forces that come into play. In order for God's power to manifest in the earth, there has to be a physical manifestation of that power. When God first spoke forth the word of creation in the earth, the scripture says, he did it by his word. Now, God's word was a lot more than just a voice going forth into the earth. God's word was a tangible manifestation of the presence of the Father in the earth. It was a tangible manifestation of the presence of God in the word. And in John 1 and verse 1, we read, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In the beginning was the Word, the Logos. And as we read through the rest of this chapter of John, we read that the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. This is speaking about the Lord Jesus Christ. When God manifested himself originally in creation, he created through the Lord Jesus Christ. He created through the Word, the Logos. The Logos was a manifestation of God in the earth. God's power had to be manifested in the earth. And as we look back in the Old Testament, we see that God, when he revealed himself, when he manifested himself to man, he did it by a manifestation, a presence. And God appeared to Moses on Mount Sinai, and he came down, and there was thunder and lightning, and Moses and Joshua and the elders of Israel walked up into the mountain. It says, and they saw the God of Israel. But the Bible says, no man has seen God at any time. There seems to be a contradiction there. How could they have seen the God of Israel if God cannot be seen? But as we read in the New Testament, we read that God gave the law through the mediation of angels. And we see a term occurring throughout the Old Testament, and it is the angel of the Lord. The angel of the Lord. God manifested his presence in the earth through what is known as a theophany. A theophany, which means a manifestation of God, an appearance of God in some form. And that form was the angel of the Lord. And the angel of the Lord appeared to all the patriarchs of old. And when God appeared to man, it was in the form of the angel of the Lord. The scriptures tell us that Jacob wrestled with a man. And when he asked him his name, he said, "Don't ask me, because it is wonderful. It is secret. And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God." Who do you suppose Jacob wrestled with? The angel of the Lord. And as Jacob lays his hands on Joseph's sons, Ephraim and Manasseh, he lays it on, he says, "The angel that redeemed me from all evil, bless the lads." What is he speaking about? He was speaking about the angel of the Lord. Whatever God does in the earth, he does by means of his special messengers or his angels. But when he acts directly upon the creation, he does it by that special manifestation known as the angel of the Lord. And so you will read in the Old Testament and also in the New Testament the manifestation of the angel of the Lord as he came to do something tangible in the earth. And in Acts chapter 12 and verse 7 we read, "And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shone in the prison, and he struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, 'Get up quickly,' and his chains fell off from his hands." Peter was in prison, ready to be taken out of prison and killed the very next day. And the scripture says the angel of the Lord appeared in that prison and loosed his chains and led him out of the prison and took him right out into the open. And he was set free. It was a miraculous physical intervention in the earth by the power of God. And it was done by the angel of the Lord. That's what it says. In Revelation 1 and verse 1, when John writes concerning the revelation that was given to him, he says, "The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him to show his servants things that must shortly come to pass. And he said and signified it by the hand by his angel to his servant John." He sent it by his angel. Well, let's see what John saw. Revelation 1 verse 16 says, "And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was as the sun shines in its strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. And he laid his right hand on me, saying to me, 'Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am he that lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of Hades and of death.'" It was Jesus speaking. But John says it was the angel of the Lord. It was the angel of the Lord. God was manifesting his presence to John in a theophany, in a physical manifestation of the presence of God, the angel of the Lord. It's a very special angel, the angel of the Lord. And when God acts in our situation, when he acts upon the creation to supersede the natural laws, to actually cause a physical change to take place, whether it be a creation or whether it be something miraculous in the sense of superseding the law of nature, God will intervene directly by that manifestation, by the angel of the Lord. But God also works through the angels of heaven. And I want to look at that a bit tonight. God works through the angels. And there's been so much talk about angels, and in recent years there's been a lot of preaching and a lot of teaching on angels. There's a lot of resurgence of interest in angels. And people are getting caught up in the worship of angels. They're being too taken up of what angels are doing. And we need to be very careful, and we need to understand how angels work and what they're supposed to do and how they operate and how they function. And that is some of what I want to try and cover tonight. I want to show you how the angelic system is set up, how the angels work, what they look like, what groups they fall into, and the kind of work that they do, and how we are supposed to respond to them, and how they will respond to us and function with us in the earth, and to cause that blessing that we spoke forth to actually begin to take place in the earth. The scripture speaks of several different groups of angels. And there's just so much in the Bible on angels that it's very difficult at times to put it all together and to understand exactly, because it's as though there's a curtain that's been put across. And the only time we get any understanding of angels is when we just see the odd angelic appearance during the course of the Bible, from the Old Testament into the New. We see angels appearing, and we can learn a little bit about angels just from how they appeared and the kind of things that angels said. And so, to understand the angelic realm, we've got to look at what the Scriptures have. And then we have to also look at what man has experienced with regard to angels. And tonight I'm going to share that, and I'm going to go beyond, and I'm going to share my own personal experiences with angels, and what God has shown me in the Spirit. And those things I cannot necessarily give you chapter and verse for, although there's plenty of evidence in the Scriptures to support what I'm going to share tonight. So I just want you to understand that I'm going to try and give you a whole big picture of the angelic realm and how it works, and as God has shown it to me, and as I've experienced it in the Spirit and continue to experience it on a regular basis. I believe the Scriptures indicate that there are three main groups of angels. Three main groups of angels. The first main group of angels are those which I would call the messenger angels. They are responsible for bringing messages. And the leader of that group of angels is the Archangel Gabriel. We all heard of Gabriel. The Scripture speaks about him many times. He appeared in the Old Testament to some of the prophets and various people. He's appeared in the New Testament. Same angel, the angel Gabriel, the leader of the messenger angels. He's an archangel. He's in charge of the others, and he holds control of that group. Now, what do messenger angels look like? Messenger angels look pretty ordinary, because as we read in the Scriptures concerning the appearance of Gabriel, he's sometimes referred to as the man Gabriel. He looked like a normal man. He looked like a normal person. When he appeared to somebody, it was not immediately obvious necessarily that he was an angel, except perhaps by the way he was dressed. I don't know. The Scriptures don't describe the angel Gabriel. But I know from my own personal experience in the Spirit and having seen these angels, they are pretty ordinary looking guys. Pretty ordinary looking. The average height, average build, average sort of person. Except dressed in clothing slightly different to what we wear today. And yet the Scripture speaks about angels having appeared to people. And when the angels appeared to Abraham, where he interceded for Lot, those three angels looked like normal men, because he immediately said, let's get a meal ready and entertain these people. They are strangers and they must be entertained. When the angels arrived at the house of Lot, the same thing. They said, come into our home, we will entertain you, we will care for you, we will feed you. They were like normal visitors, looked like normal people. Messenger angels. What do messenger angels do? They bring messages from God. The angel appears and brings a message from God. And so the angel Gabriel always was sent to bring a message from the Lord. He appeared to Daniel. He appeared to young Mary to tell her that the Holy Spirit was going to come upon her, and that she was going to conceive, and that she was going to become the mother of the Savior of the world. Very normal looking angels. We see an angel appearing to Cornelius as he is praying. We're not told that it was the angel Gabriel. There are various other angels. There's the angel that appeared to Joshua as he was about to conquer Jericho. And he identified himself as the captain of the Lord's host. Perhaps he was the angel of the Lord. Perhaps he was simply an angel that was in charge of the armies of God. An angel that was over other angels. Pretty normal, ordinary looking angels. Nothing special about them. They look like normal human beings. And these angels bring messages, they bring decrees, and they bring guidance. The angel, the messenger angel, when seen in the Spirit, will often appear with a scroll in his hand, a message from Almighty God, or a decree that needs to be issued in the earth. And those who can see angels, those who by the gift of discerning of spirits are able to look into the spiritual realm and are able to see angels, will identify these angels, and you'll find that most people will see them very much in a very similar way. But most people don't see angels. Most people are not aware that the angel is there. And yet the messenger angels still operate. The messenger angels still come and move upon people. The messenger angels still come at times and will impart thoughts into the mind, will impart and bring a spiritual influence upon people at times without them even being aware of it. When God wants to send forth a decree or a message into the earth, He does it by the mediation of angels. Just as He did on Mount Sinai. Just as God has done right throughout history. Whenever God has wanted to send something into the earth, He brings it to man. So why must the messenger angel bring it to man? Because man must issue the decree. Man must open his mouth. Man must speak forth and send forth the word of God into the earth. It is man that has the authority in the earth to speak forth God's word and God's message. I used to wait for God to send forth His decree. I used to wait for the angel. And I remember the very first time I saw an angel appear to me with a scroll in his hand. And he held it up and there was something written on it. And I thought, well, I'm waiting for the angel to speak it. But the angel didn't speak. I thought, now how am I supposed to know what the angel has said? And the Spirit of God moved upon me and I found myself bringing in utterance. And in that utterance came a prophetic word that issued forth the words of the decree that was brought to me. You say, but why does God need an angel to do that? Why doesn't God just inspire you by the Holy Spirit to do that? I don't know. I don't know, but He does. And I know there have been people have seen an angel come and they've been afraid. And they said it must be a spirit of deception. This must be Satan posing as an angel of light coming to bring me a message from the Lord. Why couldn't the Lord just tell me directly Himself? God moves in the earth by the agency of angels. And sometimes you need a stronger influence than the inner revelation of the Spirit. Because a lot of people don't listen to what comes out of their spirit. And if God was to speak in their spirit, they wouldn't hear. He's speaking 24 hours a day in your spirit. How many people hear His voice? They don't. So God sends an angel from without to bring an imprint on your mind and on your heart, to bring an external influence to bring you the message from God. That is the only reason that I can think of that God will work in this way. But I know that He does. And I know that He always has. Right back in the past. Why couldn't God just reveal it to the prophets and to Daniel when he was praying? Why did He have to send an angel? When Zacharias was praying at the time of the offering, why didn't God speak in his heart? But God sent an angel and the angel appeared to him. Sometimes man needs the manifestation of an angel before he will hear the message and the word from the Lord. And so the first group of angels is the messenger angels. Then there's a second group of angels which I call the warrior angels. The warrior angels obviously involved in warfare. They're involved in spiritual warfare in the heavenly realm. They're involved in coming into conflict with the spirits of darkness, the battle that takes place in the heavenlies. And the scriptures tell us that these angels have also a leader, an archangel that is above them, and he is the archangel Michael. The archangel Michael, you've heard about him, he's mentioned many times in scriptures. He is the leader of the warrior angels. What do the warrior angels look like? The scriptures don't really tell us much. I haven't really found a clear description in the Bible of what a warrior angel looks like. I would have thought a warrior angel would be this great hulking big giant, an awesome looking person that would terrify you. But I found actually that the warrior angel is smaller than a messenger angel. He's a short, stocky guy, and he holds a sword in his hand with a fiery look in his face. Don't underestimate his power. This is the kind of angel that wiped out half of the camp of Israel when they'd sinned, where David had to offer a sacrifice to stay the angel that was slaying. Very powerful force, a very powerful messenger of God that's involved in warfare in the heavenlies. And these angels are sent to fight on our behalf. We'll be discussing just now as we go and look at some of the demonic realm and how Satan launches his attacks against us. And we'll understand why it is that we need angels to fight on our behalf, to do warfare for us in the heavenly realm. Warrior angels can sometimes be sent forth and commissioned. And a warrior angel will sometimes appear and wait for man to send forth the word of authority for him to go forth and to do what he's supposed to do and to get into warfare. And we're going to look shortly at why that is necessary. And then there's a third group of angels, and I call them the worship angels. Worship angels. The closest description I've seen in Scripture is the one that you'll find in Isaiah chapter 6, where Isaiah had the vision of the Lord being high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple, and he saw the cherubim flying with wings. Worship angels are the only angels that have wings. And you'll notice in Isaiah's vision that the angels began to worship and cry out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is filled with his glory." Another picture that you'll find of worship angels will be when the angel appeared to the shepherds on the night of Jesus' birth to come and give the good news that a Savior had been born. And it says that the angel was joined by the heavenly host. It was a messenger angel that came to them. And suddenly that messenger angel was surrounded by a crowd of angels who were all singing out in glory. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men. Oh, they began to sing. They began to worship. That's what the worship angels are for. They come into our presence as we enter into worship. They surround us in crowds and crowds. They come and they cause the spirit to rise up. They cause our spirits to rise up. Or they cause the worship to pour forth from us. They cause a motivation and a stir within us that we get caught up into the presence of Almighty God. And if you can listen in the spirit, you will hear them sing sometimes. And you'll hear them sing with the most beautiful harmony and melody that you've ever heard. Like a heavenly choir. The worship angels. The angels of God. Who is the leader of the worship angels? We know that there are messenger angels, and the scripture tells us that the archangel Gabriel is the leader of the messenger angels. We know that there are warrior angels, and we know that the archangel Michael is the leader of the warrior angels. And now we look at the worship angels, and the scripture does not tell us, well, not obviously, who is the leader of the worship angels. Who leads the angels in worship in heaven? Who leads them and takes charge of them when they worship God? Who leads them? The scripture tells us that there was one who led them. He was known as the star of the morning. He was known as the light bringer. Lucifer. Light bringer. That's what Lucifer means. He was the anointed cherub that covers, the scripture tells us. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail tonight on Satan and his origin, but the scripture makes it quite clear as we look and read at some of these passages concerning Satan, that he was the archangel in charge of the worship angels. He was the archangel who led them in worship and praise to Almighty God. He was the archangel in charge of music in heaven. He was the archangel in charge of praise and worship. He knows all about the power that there is in praise and worship. He knows about the power there is in music and in song, in bringing the presence and the power of God. He knows all about it. And he wanted that power himself. He wanted to be worshipped. And he was cast out of heaven and all of his angels with him. Scripture says that Satan, when he fell, took with him 1/3 of the angels of heaven. There are 3 groups of angels: messengers, warriors, worship angels. When Satan fell, he took with him the worship angels of heaven. 1/3 of the angels followed him because they were under his control. 3 groups of angels. Well, I want you to know that the Bible doesn't tell us that God created new angels to take their place. But I want to tell you, I've seen worship angels. I've seen many worship angels. And they are still worship angels. But when Satan was cast out of heaven, he took with him those angels that were under his control, and they became the demon forces that are in operation in the heavenlies and in the earth today. And we're going to look at that just now as we get to it. Now, these are the 3 groups of angels which occur in the heavenly realm that the Bible tells us about. And their whole function is largely in the heavenly realm and communicating with the earth. But there is a 4th group of angels. They are very similar to the messenger angels, but they have a specialized function. And their function is confined only to the earth. And those are the guardian angels. In Matthew 18 and verse 10, Jesus, speaking about little children, said, "Take heed that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I say to you that in heaven their angels always behold the face of my Father who is in heaven." There is a specialized group of angels. And I believe they're of the messenger category. But they are a bit different, and they look different. And those who have seen them in the spirit see them as extremely large. Much bigger than life. Giants, standing very tall, looking perfectly normal, like a normal human being, except very large. What are these angels for? These angels are personal angels allocated to each and every single person who comes into this world. These angels are there to protect. To protect. These angels are also there for the purpose of provision, to take care of our needs. These angels can be commissioned by us. In Hebrews 1 and verse 13 it says, "But to which of the angels did he say at any time, 'Sit on my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool'? Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation?" Who are the heirs of salvation? Is it not we, the body of Christ, those who have been born again? They're ministering spirits. And if you look in the Greek, the word ministering refers to a public servant sent forth to minister, to attend to wait on. That's what they're there to do. To wait on the heirs of salvation. To attend to them. to attend to their needs. Do you know that you have a guardian angel, a personal angel that has been allocated to you as a child of God to attend to your needs, to wait on you? I kind of like that picture. I kind of like it when I'm sitting at a table in a restaurant and the waiter comes up and says, "Can I get you anything?" Well, most of us don't sit there and say, "No, it's all right, thanks, I'm fine." If you have a need, "Well, could you give me a glass of water, please?" "Yes, I would like another cool drink. Could we have some dessert?" He's there to wait on you. He's there to take care of your needs, your personal needs. He's been given to be a servant to you, to take care of you, to look after you, and to make sure that your every need is provided. That's what the guardian angel is for. And you have one. You have one. A personal one that's allocated just to you. If you look over your shoulder in the spirit, you might see him. But don't try, unless God reveals it to you. But he's there. He's there with you wherever you go. He's there taking care of you all the time. And I've on many occasions seen my guardian appear to me and stand waiting for me to give him instructions. He normally stands tall with a sword in his hand, ready, waiting. Waiting for me to say, "Okay, go forth now and do what needs to be done. Go forth and accomplish that which concerns me. Go forth and accomplish that which is involved in my life. Go forth and make sure that the provision which I need comes to me. Go forth and make sure that all obstacles are removed. Go take care of it. Go and arrange. Go and speak to people. Go and organize. Go and do what needs to be done in order that that which I've requested of God will come to pass in the earth." And so as you send forth your decree into the earth, as you speak forth by the power of the Spirit those words into the earth to cause a creation to take place in the earth, what immediately begins to take place is angelic activity begins to happen. The angels begin to scurry about because things need to be arranged. Sometimes people need to be moved. Sometimes people need to be persuaded. Sometimes circumstances need to be changed. Sometimes people and obstacles need to be removed. It takes a lot of arranging at times in order to bring about a fulfillment of the thing that you have spoken forth under the anointing power of God, by the Spirit, by the Word of God, into the earth. And we'll speak about it more as we go on. But there's also an angel that is allocated per church or per ministry. God allocates angels not only to individuals, but he allocates angels to groups, to situations, to organizations, to cities, to countries. How do I know that? I know that because as I turn to the book of Revelation and I see where Jesus appeared and spoke those words to the Apostle John, he said to the angel of the church at Ephesus, write. To the angel of the church of Pergamos, of Smyrna, write. To the angel of the church. Who was the angel of the church? Well, I know that a lot of people would like to say, well, he wrote to the pastor. The pastor is what the Bible is referring to there as the angel of the church. Well, I'd have you know, in those days there was no such thing as the pastor of the church. There was no one pastor in charge of a church. The scriptural pattern was a plurality of elders. And you'll see that when Paul and Barnabas went and started those new churches, they went and laid hands and ordained elders in every church. And the churches of those days were not one little church in a building. The church was the church in a community, the church in a city. Ephesus was a city, a very big city. And when God looked down upon the church in Ephesus, He didn't say there's a church in this suburb, and there's a church in that suburb, and there's another church that meet in that building over there. He looked down on Ephesus and said, the church in Ephesus. They didn't have one man in charge of them, let me tell you, that John could have written to say, well, I'm the pastor in charge of this church, and therefore I've got this message from the Apostle John, and he wrote, and this is the word of the Lord to us. John wrote, and he declared, and spoke forth into the earth to the angel that was in charge of that church. It was the angel's responsibility to communicate that message to the church in that area. A messenger angel put in charge of the church. I know this might sound different to anything you've ever heard before, but I want you to look at it. The word angel is the word angel. And that is the word that is used in the book of Revelation. And I can come to no other conclusion but that. That there was an angel put in charge of each church. And when God wrote that word and that message was communicated to the angel was responsible to make sure that that word was carried out in each one of those churches. Be that as it may, angels do not have authority in the earth. Angels do not have authority in the earth. Only one person has authority in the earth. A spirit living in a body made from the elements of the earth. Man. Man alone has been given authority in the earth. Therefore, man must grant authorization to the angels before they can do anything in the earth. In the little book of Jude, right near the end of your Bible, not many people read Jude. It's a weird book. Just got one chapter. And there's a strange little verse in there. Jude 1 and verse 9 says, yet Michael the archangel, when arguing with the devil, he was disputing about the body of Moses, dared not bring against him, the devil, a slanderous accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke you. Michael did not have authority to rebuke Lucifer. He had to say, the Lord rebuke you. And this verse just gives us a little bit of insight and some of the background of what took place when Moses died. Scripture says God buried Moses. Nobody knows what happened to his body. But this verse seems to indicate that Satan came to take that body. And God had sent the archangel Michael instead to make sure that Satan did not take that body. Because that body is going to be raised up and will appear when Moses and Elijah come back in the end times. But that's another subject altogether. Man alone has authority in the earth. The angels do not. And the angels listen only to the word of God that is uttered in the earth. The angels listen to the word of God that's uttered in the earth. How do I know that? Psalms 103 in verse 20 says, bless the Lord, you His angels that excel in strength, that do His commandments, listening to the utterance of His word. Okay, that's the GMR translation. It might sound a bit different in your Bible, but the meaning is the same. The angels listen to the voice of His word going forth into the earth. How does the word of God go forth into the earth for the angels to hear it? Through human lips. Through human lips. When man speaks forth the word of God into the earth, the angels pay heed. So when you speak forth those spiritual forces of faith, hope, and love, by the rhema word of God, speaking it forth into the earth, the angels prick up their ears. They say, that's God speaking there. That's the word of God that's going forth into the earth, that shall not return void, but shall accomplish that for which it is sent. And the angels immediately begin to respond to that word, and they begin to act on it. So as we speak forth the word
based on God's word, that when our words are the very rhema word, that they become a thus saith the Lord. As the prophet gives forth his decree into the earth, the angels immediately respond to that decree. They immediately respond to that word and they begin to work and to accomplish and to cause to take place in the earth those words which were decreed and sent forth into the earth. And so when we, in the name of Jesus, as man in Christ, bearing in mind that we lost that authority in Adam, but in Christ that authority was restored, because Jesus took back the authority that Adam had, and Jesus gained even higher authority because he was given the name that is above every name. That at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow of things in heaven, the angels, of things in earth, angels also, and earthly powers, and under the earth the demon forces, and we'll get to that just now. Man has the authority to command the angels in the name of Jesus. Only in the name of Jesus, only in Christ, only as we speak in Him and through Him and by Him and send forth His word into the earth, the angels must bow, they must obey, they must be servants who come running and say, "Yes, Master, what do I do next?" They must obey His voice, His word uttered into the earth. And so we, as God's representatives in the earth, in Christ, we create the authorization. We give the authority for the angel to work. We give the authority. The angels do not have that authority on their own until we give it to them. And if we do not give them that authority, they cannot work. Their hands are bound. They are tied. They are restricted. And a lot of the time, the words that we speak into the earth are negative words of destruction, are negative words that authorize the powers of darkness instead of the angels of God. We've got to speak forth God's words into the earth. And when we speak of God's words into the earth, the angels will take heed and they will obey and they will begin to arrange and to cause to take place in the earth the words that we have spoken. And when we stop speaking those words, we take away their authority and they become powerless to do anything for us. They cannot protect us. They cannot watch over us. They cannot cause our provision to come to us until we speak forth the words of God into the earth. That's the work of angels. Now,